Okay, guys, 1101, let's get started. So good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining Elite CISO's weekly Elite Knowledge Session that we conduct on every Thursday, 11 o'clock India time. And today's partner is DNIF. And the topic that we are going to talk about is very interesting. It is the future of SIM, the journey from traditional to hyperscale SIM. And to talk about this topic, we have Mr. Soumen Das Gupta, who is founder and CEO of DNIF with us. And Mr. Soumen will talk about different aspects around SIM and most importantly, three bullet points that you see over here, right? Solution to the challenges of scale. So we have seen that, okay, organizations are now going to cloud and, you know, there are huge assets to be managed. So how do we handle this challenge of scale where you have huge deployments on the cloud and the data you need to collect on SIM? So that challenge is pretty big for the organization. So we will hear from Mr. Gupta how we can manage this challenge. And the second is the coverage gap, right? Because you have got workload on the cloud, whether it is AWS or Azure, you've got applications, you've got IoT devices now. So how do you ensure that all these devices are covered and they are sending logs to your centralized SIM? So that is something is a challenge for CIOs and CISOs. So that's what we will try to understand what suggestions Mr. Gupta has to share around this, and then reducing total cost of ownership, right? Because if you are sending lot of SIM, lot of data to SIM, then the cost could be very high, right? And apart from it, even from the assets perspective, you have got multiple EC2 instances that you are scaling up and down, and then how do you ensure that you are taking care of the cost as well? So those are the three broad topics that Mr. Gupta is going to talk about. And from the agenda perspective, as you can see on the slide, and every time we run a typical session, so quick welcome, and then we will have a quiz. It's a two-question quiz. Again, the quiz format is fastest finger first, so you have to answer the quiz quickly on the chat, right? So even if you do not know the answer, you are going to search in the Google, so do it quickly and put it in the chat. And then this will be quick 5-minute introduction and quiz, and then we will have the core session of DNIF. And then at the end, we will save about 10 minutes for Q&A. So Q&A we will take live, okay? There is no panelist from DNIF side who is going to answer the questions while the session is going on. So we will wait till the end for the questions to be answered, okay? So we will request you to raise your hand and then we will unmute you and then you can ask your question. And then I will share the secret to download your participation certificate. We will have Wheel of Fortune as we always do. And the giveaway is Amazon Alexa. And then we will open registration for next week. And the slides will be available. Session is being recorded. So this will go on Elite CISO's YouTube channel. And you can view it over there as well. Just give me one moment. Quick. Great. So the next thing is stand and attend. If you are new, if you're joining this for the very first time, this may be something new for you. But if you have been attending, you know that in every webinar, every Thursday, we throw this challenge of stand and attend. Now, this challenge is related to the overall fitness that we drive in the community, right? So Elite CISO has got a very active fitness community. It is not something that we started now. We have been running this initiative from past couple of years now. As of I think this last weekend itself, we completed 200 days of fitness. So on 1st January 2021, the members took the challenge of 325 days of fitness. So what we said that in year 2021, out of 365 days, 325 days, we are going to be physically active, whether it is running, swimming, squash, jogging, whatever, yoga, whatever you want to do, you have to stay active. And this weekend we completed 200 days of fitness, and that's what the celebration was about. Now, around fitness itself, this is what the initiative we run of stand and attend. So if you sit the entire day, right, because we are in like work from home kind of situation, we are sitting a lot. So if you sit, you will get all this problem, like foggy brain, weak abs, soft glute, and all those things. And you will not be able to focus on the things that you're doing. So what we do is we ask you and we give you this stand and attend challenge. So this webinar or this session that you're going to attend, stand while attending it. See, I'm also standing, right? And I think Mr. Gupta, you are also standing, right?
Yes, absolutely.
That's wonderful. Awesome. So if you stand, you will have less pain in your body. Your heart will be healthier. You will have more energy. You will lose weight and you will think sharper. Okay, guys. So stand and let's see how many of you are going to accept this challenge. If you're accepting this challenge, go to the chat and type yes, as we always ask. That's great. I love this chat blinking, chat going crazy. So many people are accepting this challenge. Amazing. Absolutely. Guys. Amazing. Awesome. Great. Now you are standing, so you can focus and you can think sharper, because the next is the quiz that we are going to do. Okay. Again, it's a two-question quiz. Winner will get Amazon voucher worth 1,000 rupees. And it is fastest finger first. So we are going to monitor chat. And if you know the answer, type it quickly in the chat and send it to all participants, not just panelists. Okay, guys. Again, I try to get the question from the topic itself. So if we are doing ransomware, I try to get the questions around ransomware. Today we are talking about SIM. So the questions are around SIM itself. Okay. Here goes the first question. Be attentive, guys. What is the event ID number when event viewer security locks are cleared on Windows machine? So hackers breach into your system, they get access to it, and then they clear the event log so that nobody can trace them. I can see chat is blinking. I will look at after the, once my part is done, I will look at the chat and see who the first one is. So the answer is 1102. Okay, so event viewer ID 1102, you should be monitoring on your SIM. There should be a dashboard which will say event log cleared 1102, and we count. If it is zero all the time, you are good. If it goes to one, that means somebody has cleared the Windows security logs, and then you should be paying attention to that. Okay, I've seen like a lot of people are answering. That's great. Second question coming up, guys. Second question is again related to SIM, again related to event viewer ID. Second question is, what is the event ID number when a new service is installed on your Windows machine? So you have to type the event ID number. I can again see the chat is going crazy. A lot of people are typing it. Awesome, guys. Why this is important is because, let's say you have a standard environment, right? No new service should be getting installed every other day. It's a standard environment. You have done all the deployment, all the softwares are installed. But if you see all of a sudden new services are being installed, that could indicate a hacking attempt, right? I mean, apart from your routine Windows software installation and all, if somebody is running, let's say a PSExec on your machine, or running a Metasploit on your machine, right, remotely. So this will install a service, and that service ID is 7045. So this 7045 also you should monitor on your SIM. So these were the two questions. I will go through the chat and see who gave the right answers. I hope this quiz, you learned something out of it, and then you can take it and implement in your organization. Okay, guys, 174 people I see right now. Thanks, guys, for joining it. With this, over to you, Mr. Gupta.
All right. Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. Let me figure out a way to share my screen. Okay. Does everybody have something on screen? All right. Yep. So first of all, thank you so much and good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here on a weekday, dodging work. A pleasure to be, talking to you. I mean, unfortunately, this has to happen in this manner. Would love to be, in front of you in person, but nevertheless, let's make the best of this. So my name is Shamiran Dasgupta. I'm the founder of NIF. And NIF is a hyperscale big data platform performing SIM functions, SIM SOAR UEBA functions. I'm here to essentially talk about where the future is. When the moment you talk about future, you want to bring perspective. So want to talk about what, where we've come from and where we're trying to go. Future is always very blurry, right? And as we move forward, things become clearer and clearer. So, I mean, I'm going to talk about the direction. And as we move in that direction, things will hopefully get clearer for all of us going forward. So And so quickly, the agenda, looking at the past, looking how, I mean, so simple pattern, let's talk about a problem, let's talk about cost of that problem, let's talk about what solutions you can expect. I am hoping to have enough time left to show you some screens, a small little demo if possible. And for that, I have a lot of content in slides, right? I mean, this is just a disclaimer. I have a lot of content in slides. I've kept those slides just so that it's not necessary we'll go through each of these slides in detail, but I've kept them so that when you get a download of these slides, you can actually verify and validate those points and go over the content properly in detail. So obviously we don't have enough time to pull that off in a short period of time. What I will also do is try and finish early so that we can spend more time in Q&A, because this is a very dynamic space, right? And I'm sure all of you have been using a sim for a while and definitely have relevant questions. So I'd like to spend more time there. So let's see how that goes. Okay, let's move forward. Looking back, where are we? The first thing, right, that came up was the rules engine. The first sim had nothing but collection capability. We had a term called normalization. So we would be able to normalize data and be able to take, reduce size by deduplicating events, right? So, and then be able to run simple rules, like we were able to find threshold-based capabilities at that point, right? Doing simple things like brute force or multiple virus infection attempts on a particular system. Those kind of scenarios, simple scenarios we were able to do with a rules engine. Next came was a correlation engine. We could actually take two devices and figure out if a particular event had its traces on multiple devices, not just two, multiple devices. If those traces were there, then we were essentially saying that, oh, because multiple devices are saying this is an attack, I will call this an attack, right? So that was our strategy. And this is still a strategy which is very rampantly used, right? Where you're saying, if my IDS and my firewall and my antivirus are saying the same thing, then probably this is a real threat. So that's the tech we used in the correlation. That's the strategy we use for detection, correlation engines. Third game, big data. As soon as the SIM became popular, we had more and more customers bringing more data into the platform. And soon SQL systems or RDBMS systems were not able to scale fast enough. So then the problem was, how do you accommodate more data, right? I mean, at that point, customers were growing twice or thrice their data footprint every year, right? Right now they're still doing twice, but at that point there's most of my customers, large customers, were doing thrice the data footprint, and that was a big challenge. So we had to figure out how are we going to accommodate this data onto the same database, right? So there we started exploring big data as a solution, and then we came to horizontally scalable data structure. So what would happen is you could have cluster of three servers and you had more data, you could add four and five servers to the cluster and make the cluster take more data and provide the same kind of capability. After that came analytics, right? And in analytics, what happened is we started using analytical models, machine learning tools, AI-based capability to identify outliers, identify bad behavior. So now our strategy is changing from correlation to figuring out what's not normal, right? So because the challenge was that we were always focused on detecting known threats. When we are focused on detecting known threats, you are able to correlate that because you know what the signature looks like. After a point, we were starting to figure out that, hey, listen, known threats is easy, but most of the threats that hit us and hit us bad are unknown threats that were not discovered earlier. So then we started figuring out how are we going to go outside the syllabus and be able to still detect these threats, right? So then we outlier detection became a very big requirement, and figuring out that if Shamiran is an administrator, but he's usually not creating user accounts, right? And today Shamiran creates a user account, that becomes, hey, listen, something not right about him today, right? And if there are more such events that he's done today, which are not normal, seems like either Shamiran has mal intent or somebody stolen Shamiran's password, right? So, I mean, that's how analytics came about. And then let's talk about disruptions now, right? The rules engine came in 2002. Right about the time we started this organization. 2007, we had a full correlation-based engine available. 2007 onwards, most of the players were probably able to provide correlation clearly. 2012 was the big data challenge where we were. And so the reason you see these size of these circles growing, these are the number of SIEM adopters at that point. I've put that in ratio so that you figure out that how many deployments were there of a SIEM in 2002, how many were there in 2007. Not a lot changed between 2002 and 7, but a lot changed in 2012. 2017, where analytical engines came in, you saw the size of the market growing substantially, right? Almost triple the size from 2012. So what's next? To us, hyperscale seems like the next big thing for us. When you say hyperscale, it's very easy to imagine that, oh, unlimited scale, maybe that's what you're talking about. But I think this whole presentation is about what's hyperscale, right? We will talk about why, what are the challenges that we need to solve, and how hyperscale is going to help us solve it. All right. Broken story. 88% of compromised victims had a SIEM deployed. Now that's, I mean, everybody knows this. So this is still a broken story, right? I mean, for us, most of us have a SIEM installed, have antivirus, have all the security paraphernalia, but you still seeing break-ins, you're still seeing compromise, you're still seeing, you know, headlines with cybersecurity. Not that these people who are in the headlines didn't have a SIEM deployed or had really good people monitoring them. What happened? Why is that breaking? This is completely my perspective, right? So I mean that we're trying to put some thought process into that and try and figure out where these holes are. So if you're a customer, right, you're still responsible for enabling and configuring the right detection models, right? So the SIEM provider is saying that, hey, listen, I will give you content, right? And you will enable those content, you will configure that content, you will all the rules and the correlation logic or the machine learning models, I will give it to you. But you enable them and you configure them, and I think you should be responsible for your own cybersecurity. That to me is broken, right? We'll talk about that in detail later. Responsible, again, then also that the customer or the user is now also responsible for uncovering campaigns. Right. So earlier we were dealing with alerts. One brute force attack happened on that machine. Somebody used SMB traffic on that and on machine number 16. That seemed like normal, and we were dealing with those threats individually. But now our challenge is, how are we going to figure out we are being hit by a campaign? How do we figure out we are being hit by China Chopper, for instance? Right? How do we figure out these kind of campaigns are hitting us? And recognize at a campaign level, which means I need to zoom out, come back, and start to figure out what's happening in this environment and be able to connect these dots. So most of these systems are not able to connect these dots, and the connecting dots responsibility remains on the user or the customer, not the SIEM vendor itself. Okay, let's talk about scale for a minute. Right. Today, what's happening with scale, and that's why I think the solution is a broken solution. We have big data solutions, and big data solutions mean that when I want to go from 10 terabytes to maybe 30 terabytes, I just need to pile on more hardware. Just put more fuel into the fire, make a bigger fire is what we talk about. But the challenge in that is that when you have a bigger environment, larger cluster, there are more points of failure, right? And when there are more points of failure, you need something breaking all the time. So you need a lot of redundancy. So then cost of redundancy is very expensive. And then because you're almost doubling your circuit all the time. And plus, the moment you go beyond a certain space or size, you will need administrators to just manage this infrastructure. So there are customers who run a SIM operation that have 350 servers running just data platform, running the, just the data platform. So at, if you have 350 servers, anything can break at any point, right? And the moment something breaks, the cluster becomes unstable. That's a big challenge. So you cannot have a situation where you just have to pile on more hardware to grow the setup, right? So that's the rate at which we are growing is unreal. So that's one major issue. Losing track, I'm going to breeze through this one. So essentially what's happening is cost becomes one major hurdle in growth, right? I mean, most people in India will, or anywhere in the world also will agree that cost of a SIM is one thing, but cost of the hardware required for the SIM, the cost of administrators required for the SIM, the cost of security engineers required for the SIM, the cost of analysts required for the SIM, or if you are running with the MSS provider, cost of an MSS provider put together of running a SIM, the cost of the operation of a SIM itself is very, very expensive, right? And which is directly proportionate to the data that you're ingesting. So if you get more data, you're going to have to pay more, right? That's a problem. And because the cost is a limiting factor, you are limiting yourself in coverage. You are saying that, okay, let's only talk important devices. Let's only talk most important log sources, right? Let's not take everything out of the estate, right? I mean, I have one line at the bottom of this, which is one of my favorites. I mean, probably write a book about this. Adversaries always start from the bottom of the list, right? An attacker never goes to the top of the list and hammers a gold device or a platinum device. It always goes, you know, most of these guys walked in either from the air conditioner server or the receptionist server or from the Xerox machine, right? So this is how they break in. And if you don't have the same kind of coverage that you have from your platinum devices down at the bottom, it will break in. They break in and then they you exploit trust relationships and walk across the environment over time. And they have lots of time on their hands. So therefore, you're not able to make, because coverage is less, you're not able to make connections. Right? So this I will have to demo to you to explain this conversation. Run through this again. Detection fidelity is completely governed by cost. I mean, that's something that we were talking about right now. Active Directory is a sample, right? So the gray circle is the volume of data that you have. The blue circle is the quality of data that you have, that quality of data that contributes to real alerts, real threats, right? So you have, let's say, 100 megs of data, and you have about 50 megs of data that contributes to quality threat detection, right? So the Active Directory is like that. Proxy server, the odds are even worse. Proxy and firewall server, odds are even worse. But endpoint detection, for instance, right? You're seeing that you have, let's say, 100 megs of data, but 90 megs of data is very, very valuable for you, right? This is the general lay of the land, right? I mean, and of course, these are approximate numbers, but generally true across customers, right? If you see what is the cost of ingesting Active Directory data, firewall data, and endpoint data, right? So endpoint data is obviously the most expensive. If you get endpoint telemetry, that's going to be the real thing, but it's going to cost you a bomb, right? And when you bring that data, your EPS value goes up, your software license value goes up, your hardware requirement goes up, your administration cost goes up, your MSSP is going to charge you more because you're going to see more alerts, right? Everything's going to go up in cost. So what do? We include this in scope. Yes, Active Directory is included in most cases. Firewall is always included in all cases, but most of us manage to exclude the EDR data or response data or endpoint data or endpoint telemetry, as we call it, from the SIM scope just because it's mind-bogglingly expensive. So this is Now you're seeing that cost directly impacts quality of detection. Right? That's a point I wanted to prove here. Campaign discovery is totally dependent on human analysis. I'm breezing through this one. So today what's happening is you are getting alerts, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 alerts, and you have analysts sitting in your security operations center that are watching these alerts. It's a first in, first out kind of first in, last out kind of queue. And as an analyst gets open, right, and the analyst is, you know, as the analyst gets available, a new alert is given to them and they deal with that alert. What we are not able to do is you are not able to zoom out to see the larger picture and see how these alerts are connected to each other. That is one of the biggest challenges. And that today, if you see that endpoint devices or EDR organizations are able to do that on the endpoint devices level itself, right? Because they are able to tell that, hey, listen, this EXE launched, this PowerShell launched this EXE, Word document launched this PowerShell, launched this EXE, and now you have a backdoor sitting on your machine, right? So they are able to track that because the entire attack surface is in their control itself. What happens with a SIM is the entire attack surface is not in their control. Sometimes you have EDR data, sometimes you have proxy data, sometimes you have firewall data or Active Directory data, and you're never able to stitch that total picture together. So SIM vendors struggle to give you that visibility. Right. That's one of the biggest challenges that we are seeing today. And because all the data is not there, you are not able to connect the dots because you can see one side of the picture and then you can see the other side of the picture. But the item that connects these two pictures together is not there. So visibility is limited and you are not able to make connections just because visibility is limited and all data types are not there. Right. And then here we are also saying that the responsibility of connecting the dots remains on the customer itself. It's not done by the vendor. It's not done by the platform. It's required to be done at the customer level. It's required to be done at the operator's level, right? So that's a problem. When you start depending on human beings, sometimes you can get it right. But in most cases, you're going to have a bad day. Right. So, I mean, that's the problem. The consistency is not there with human beings. All right. This one's a very cool thing. So when we bought a antivirus system, right, or when you bought an IPS, right, the antivirus vendor gave us signatures. The IPS guy gave us signatures and says, "Sir, you don't have to worry. This antivirus can detect all attacks, right? And we will constantly update your signature database to make sure that you are able to detect all the latest attacks." So the onus of and the responsibility of detection was on the antivirus vendor, right? Same thing happened with IPSs. The IPS was responsible to give us signatures in 4 hours of a zero day being detected. So those kind of SLAs were being signed at that point. What happened with the SIM? The SIM vendor is saying something else. SIM vendor is saying, here's a SIM platform. I have this wonderful portal where there are lots of signatures and apps and correlation logic available. You can look at it. These are all out of the box. Pick what you want, enable them, configure them to your requirement, and then you have a awesome detection story and you'll be able to detect attacks. True. But none of these SIM vendors are taking responsibility of detecting, right? I mean, I know that SIM vendors are making an effort, but we're not actually taking ownership of detection. Right? This seems like a major challenge. I'm just putting all the content on screen so that you can, refer to this offline. So here we need to get to a point where the SIM vendor becomes responsible for detection as well, right? And has a role to play in detection, not just create a library, right? The problem here is now, who is then actually creating and enabling signatures? The guy at the bottom of the pyramid, the guy with least amount of experience, the least amount of vision is actually creating, modifying, downloading out of the box content and enabling them, disabling them, right? Writing filters for them or configuring them. Absolutely at the bottom of the pyramid, and we are leaving our the responsibility of our security depends on how that person does their job. It's unfair to my eyes. So this is a problem that we need to figure out how to solve. Okay, we are about 30 minutes down. Let's talk about what's hyperscale. Everybody say that hyperscale means being able to scale data platform infinitely, and you'll be able to scale, do a lot of stuff. So no, it's not just the ability to scale infinitely, right? It's more of the, I mean, if I write that, I had to, you know, when I was doing this slide, I wanted to define it. It's the ability to scale infinitely at an extremely affordable cost and find threat campaigns without active human participation. So this is where hyperscale will actually impact us, right? We have the ability to scale today, but the cost of scale is extremely high, right? So the solution to scale is there, but the cost at which that scale happens is crazily expensive. So, I mean, you're seeing any cloud operator, right, doing SIEM has a very, extraordinarily exorbitant per GB price, right, if you see any of those providers. And the reason for that is the scale at which and the rate at which things can go wrong for them is very, very high as well. So the problem, if they have to beat their odds, their per GB price or the per terabyte price has to be very high. So this is one of the major challenges that we are all facing right now. And if you would truly be able to scale when you are able to scale at a cost which is extremely low, and that does not impact your pocket. And because if you're able to do that, then what happens? A lot of cascading benefits come across, right? So first, we'll talk about what is hyperscale first for a minute, and then we'll talk about the benefits of hyperscale. One way of, you know, sort of achieving hyperscale, this is something that we've done, is compression. This is an absolutely industry leading. It took us 6 years to, you know, sort of figure this out over a very long period of time, right? Just to give you perspective, we started with about 45% compression, then we went to about 70% compression, and then about 70-75% compression is where we locked out, right? Most vendors compress between about 50% to about 70-80% compression capability. Most vendors are able to provide for live queryable data, right? So if you want to query that data, that has to be between upwards of 80% compression. But at the archive level, we are all able to achieve about 90-95% compression, right? One way we've been able to solve the hyperscale problem is by figuring out compression technology, which is very, very custom to this problem statement, right? So we currently, for live queryable data, we are currently at 98.4% compression for log volume. So which makes us extremely, extremely cost efficient in terms of compression. So the moment you're able to compress this data and you're still able to query that information in real time, that makes you, makes your hardware requirement go from, you know, 100 to about 32, right? So that's the kind of saving that you'll have. So if you're putting that 98% in perspective, if you are 100 and if you have 10,000 GB of data, right, of log events, and if you had to write that to disk, you would essentially write it to about 160 GB on disk only. So 10,000 GB will get reduced to 160 GB on disk. So this is real. This has happened, and we are doing this. This is one problem that we are solving. So what is the impact? Let's understand impact. This is going to be, you know, the pivotal part of this presentation. Extreme compression reduce. So I'm going to read so that you know I'm fairly accurate in what I'm saying. Extreme compression reduces the data footprint. So you are reducing the data footprint maximally. Smaller clusters equals reduced failures, right? So if data footprint is smaller, your cluster size will reduce, the redundancy rate that you need will reduce, the failure rate will reduce. So all of this will reduce, right? Smaller cluster equals reduced cost, includes administrators. So the number of people that you require to manage these clusters because your cluster size is smaller will reduce. The reduced cost, the cost of scale is lower. Reduced cost means more data, right? All of us want to bring more data, but it's cost prohibitive, right? And just because it's cost prohibitive, I don't want to bring more data. And more data essentially becomes, if I get more data in, I get better connections. I'm able to connect the dots better. And I can actually achieve what, at an organization level, across your VPN server, across your proxy server, across your firewall and Active Directory and endpoint, I'm able to connect those dots like you would see on an EDR system right now, right? You are able to build that connected signals view. So, and all this equals no blind spots, right? All of us have blind spots today, and we need to figure out a way to cover those blind spots. More data will give you better coverage. Better coverage means lesser blind spots, right? This is where we are, and how compression will yield better capability, detection capability is what we are assuming, right? I mean, this is a direction in which we are moving forward. There is a lot that we haven't discovered. There is a lot that we are working on right now, and we hope that, you know, it fructifies, right? So there are certain amount of the certain research capabilities that we are trying to bring in, which may get solved, but might not be production worthy. So I mean, there are lots of hit and miss in researching forward, but when something hits, I mean, this is one of those things that hit and has really benefited us massively. All right, let me jump over to a demo, right? Hang on. Okay. Good time to refresh. All right, so this is just take 10 minutes. What I want to, sort of ascertain in the demo is what's the impact that you will find in detection capability, right? How will you figure out quality detection and how will you, so one of the major parts of quality detection is visibility into detection, right? So I mean, I'm going to put a very common attack, attack classification methodology in front of you. So this is a take on the MITRE attack framework, right? And these are the tactics and techniques that you have there. If anybody needs a primer, just drop me a message. I'll probably, be able to send you some material or we can have a chat. If you're not introduced to the MITRE attack framework and why it is important, if you want to know that, please get in touch, because this is mighty, mighty important for being able to control your detection capability, right? And one of the most important things is whether you're able to measure your detection capability or not, right? So here what's happening is these are all the different techniques that exist today, right? And the boxes that have lit up, right, are the boxes that we have detection capability for. Right, I have logic to detect these attacks right now, but the boxes that are not lit up, right, I don't have the capability to detect them right now. So today, when you deploy a SIM or you deploy an AV or you deploy a detection device, most of us don't have the visibility of what we can detect and what we can't detect. What is the percentage of visibility? What is the percentage of attacks that I can detect today? And what are the percentage of attacks I can't detect today, right? Nobody knows what's our blind spot. We can only say that I spent $2 million on cybersecurity last year, right? But none of us can, talk about, oh, I can do 98 out of 100 or I can do 68 out of 100. Nobody has that figure. So the attack MITRE framework will give you a capability or a method to measure this. right? So the MITRE framework, essentially here what we've done is we've layered the MITRE framework, and we've layered our detection capability on top of MITRE framework, on the MITRE framework itself. You will see that there are so many blind spots still we are not able to detect, right? And it's easy for us, because then what happens is we know exactly where we need to put in our work, right? We don't need to detect more public facing application, because we have 12 detection workbooks already, right? We need to put stress on how we are going to detect inter-process communication, for instance, right? And cover all of these blocks as we go forward. One more reason that I'm showing you these blocks is that all the big devices that we usually detect, right, that we usually induct in our logging process, usually contributes to the left side of this pane, right? So it gives you initial access, execution, persistence, and privilege escalation. All that, it gives you visibility to that. But when you're looking at lateral movement or collection or CNC or exfiltration, you need more fidelity. That means more data needs to come in for those boxes to light up. So that becomes a major challenge. What happens is, so you have symptoms of attack. When you're looking at a SIM, typically you have symptoms at and you can't put the SIM to blame on this one, because what happens is if you don't induct the right kind of data into your SIM, the SIM will not be able to detect give you the full picture, right? So it's very important for you to know what data types to induct, right? So that's the question that all customers are asking. Oh, tell me, what kind of data should I bring onto my SIM so that I get better detection? And we almost have a template answer. We say, okay, sir, proxy server leke aate hain, and then firewall and some Windows servers and AD information. I think these are the things that you should integrate. But that's a very template answer. Here, what you will be able to do is, if you look at hit the streams button, here you're going to be able to see the different types of data that are currently coming in. IAM data is the authentication data, Sysmon registry, Sysmon file. These are endpoint data. Sysmon process is again endpoint data. Threat is, you know, point detection solutions that are giving us information. Authentication data is who logged in, logged out, irrespective of whether it's a Windows machine or a Linux machine or a Palo Alto firewall, right? Then this is firewall information, right? Then there is audit information, configuration information. Configuration will tell you, who created this user, who installed some software, right? All this information will go into configuration data. Now, if you click on any of these, so let's click on IAM, for instance, you will see that IAM can detect attack account manipulation. So when you bring in IAM data, account manipulation will get activated, right? But when you get firewall data, there are so many other blocks that get activated. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Seven blocks get activated with the firewall, right? If you get authentication data, you will only be able to detect brute force and external remote services kind of attacks. These are the two blocks that get illuminated. If you get threat data, you get phishing, you get user execution, right? There are two, three different types of capabilities that have come with threat data. But if you get Sysmon process data, you see the number of blocks that light up over here. So that tells you that if you bring Sysmon data, process data, you will have a lot of detection capability. So the value for bringing Sysmon data is very, very high. That's exactly what I was talking about over there in that one slide where you had these two concentric circles showing you endpoint data, which contributes to a lot of detection capability, but most of us are not bringing Sysmon data or EDR data or EDR telemetry into the SIM itself, right? So now, if you want to see, if I bring CloudTrail data, how many detection types can happen? If I bring Azure data or Windows audit data or DNS data, what kind of attacks I can detect? So if you click on these, it will tell you all the different types of, use cases also. So if you want to see Sysmon data and muddy water attack, right? So this is the query that will run. This is the logic which is available in the system itself. So, and it will also raise a signal if this comes through. So this is This happens from the MITRE ATT&CK framework that we just spoke about. Next, I want to talk about is streams. Streams is essentially where we are talking about the compression. Very, very simple. This is, you know, we are at two of the three things that I want to show you here. There is a lot to show, but that's not the objective. If you get 248 GB of data, I will have to enrich, parse that data, add metadata to it, and add enrichment data to it. It will become 425 gigs of data. Right? When 425 gigs of data is written to disk, it boils down to just 19 gigs on disk. Right? So there is, as you can see, there is not a lot of data on this. This is a dummy demo server. And therefore, we are getting about 95.4% compression on this, right? So what happens is when this volume will increase as this data increases, the data set increases, your compression ratio will also increase. It will go to about 98.5, 98.4% compression across data types. So if you see over here, there is 131 gigs of, let's say 39 gigs of volume for thread. Enriched volume is about 66, size on disk is about 2 GB. Right, so about 96%, 98% compression. So as you have lesser data, the compression ratio will reduce. But when the bulk increases, the compression ratio will increase and your footprint will keep getting reduced over time. So this is the number two thing. Now this contributes massively to the size of infrastructure that you have. Size of infrastructure will contribute to number of people you need. And of course the number of threads that you will need to manage. So all those things are completely related. When cost of scale is reduced, you will bring more data, you will essentially have lesser blind spots. All right, last thing that I want to show and end this conversation with is I want to go to signals, right? This is your attack footprint. This is how you see, everybody sees attacks, right, today. And our analysts start from number one, then the second guy goes to number two, then we go through this like it's a pipeline. However, we don't want you to see it this way. We wanted to basically figure out a way where we could connect all these threads that you're seeing. And of course, you're seeing 79 new signals, unique suspects, unique targets, and unique detections. All of this is also linked to the MITRE framework. So defensive evasion, masquerading, or lateral movement, remote services, all this is happening, right? So instead of going sequentially on these threads, right, is there a better way of doing that? Was the question that we were asking. And how will we be able to connect the dots? Most of our customers are bringing a hell lot of information into their data space just because it does not cost them, right? By the way, we offer device-based licenses. Device-based licenses means you bring one device, I will charge you an X amount. That device can produce 3 GB of data or 30 GB of data or 300, 1 lakh EPS of data. I will still charge you that one device price. So there is no limiting you by saying, oh, you can't bring in more data. Actually, we want you to bring in more data so that the visibility matrix increases and you don't have blind spots, right? So with this, what you're able to do is, instead of going sequentially, you will hit this thing called view graph. And what it does is it's able to connect the different signals together, right? And is able to tell you that which of these threads are connected and how they're connected and what is the attack progression that you're seeing today. This is of amazing value is because you are now seeing cluster number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 clusters of signals, which means you just need to deal with 6 different cases. Earlier, we had to open a case and then we had to figure out which of these alerts are part of this case. And we had to do that manually. right? Here, the system will essentially connect the dots for you and give it to you. And there is a possibility that this entire family is connected to this family also. But there is some data between these that is missing. And that's why these connections are not getting, clusters are not getting connected. So when you bring in more data, you will see a more connected pattern going through. We are using, I'm going to say this for the last time, use this word for the last time. We are using cognitive machine learning for identifying this. And this understands your environment, understands the pattern of work, and connects more dots as you go forward. It becomes better and better as you learn. All right, so let's investigate one of these and see how, you know, what it looks like. Click on one of these and it'll tell you, okay, this is what it is. Essentially what's happening here is that this is, by the way, we are basically replaying a CTF data set, all right? So you are able to see real attacks. Here you have an IP address, external IP address, suspect. It does a brute force access on this particular machine. Now, everything yellow is also coming to you as a UEBA alert. So a UEBA is telling you that, hey, listen, there's a behavioral problem with this machine right now, right? So everything that's yellow is UEBA. Everything that blue is essentially a signal that has been raised, an alert that has been raised, right? So from here, you have a concurrent login going on to with this particular user. So there is somebody called Theo Hamilton, which is getting used as a user, and you're logging to, and based with that, you are creating a user, right? So you're creating and deleting in a very short time. You created basically a user called Malministrator, and Malministrator essentially is now logging into so many different machines using command line execution with suspicious URL and app data string. So it's the same attack on all the different machines. So one user, it creates a user. So what you're seeing is one machine got infected, a user got compromised, a user got created, and then this user is being used to execute command lines, commands on all these machines. So this is a lateral movement kind of an example. And this is what lateral movements look like. And you are able to visually quickly see that something seriously going wrong here, right? So essentially, if you have, so moral of the story right now, where I would want to, you know, sort of summarize is, if you bring more data onto a platform, you will be able to see more connections. This kind of capability is now coming forward on SIMs as well. And if you bring more visibility, you will see more connected graphs, and you will be able to, then what happens is, right, after this, at this point, what happens is, you know that you just have to deal with these six problems. You do not have to deal with 65 alerts or 150 alerts. You just have to deal with six different scenarios, and you need to spend your time on only that. So the number of hours that you spend dealing with threats and headlessly dealing with threats will completely reduce, right? So with that, I'd say thank you. It was a pleasure bringing this to you. I'd love to answer questions from here. We have some time left, so over to you.
Great, Soumen. Thanks a lot. Great session. So for Q&A, I think we can take about two questions. We are running out of time. It's already 11:54. So probably we can take two questions. So guys, if you want to ask live question, go ahead, raise your hand, and then we will unmute you and you can ask your question. So Mr. Rajesh, okay. So allowed to talk, unmute. Yeah, Mr. Rajesh, go ahead, please ask your question.
Hi Rajesh, you're on mute though.
Okay, Mr. Satyendra Srivastav, you are next. Please go ahead, ask your question.
Because you need to unmute them.
Yeah, I've already done that.
You still seem to be mute.
Yeah, I've already unmuted them. Next, I'm going to Vikas, allowed to talk, asked to unmute.
Hi, Shamran. My next question is, how are you making the life of a stock analyst easier? The challenge is that you have so much data still coming in. From a same perspective, your stock analyst role, one is your visual graphing, but what else are you doing to make the stock analyst role easier or reducing it? Because finally, the person sitting there and the incident response aspect would be more, would matter more from the final user's perspective.
Sure. So, Vikas sir, I think the bigger challenge that we have in front of us is how are we going to collate information and group them up into smaller blocks? The moment we are able to aggregate them into smaller clusters, the amount of time that an analyst needs to spend is lesser. The big difference between yesterday and today for an analyst's life is that the analyst is now going to be fed with information of all these threads being connected together, right? Versus different alerts coming to them and for them to realize that, hey, these six alerts are actually connected. They have to make that connection. Here, we are making that connection for them, right? So this is one major improvement in where the analyst was and where the analyst is going to be. Of course, then the moment this happens, your playbooks can be different because now you're dealing with series of threats, not just a single threat. And so when automated incident response becomes substantially easier going forward as well. So the number of playbooks that you need to have will reduce. You don't have to memorize those things. All in all, a lot of time you will save on the analyst bench. And more so, you will get better quality detection because you will have access to the larger picture. I think it's going to be a detection benefit, direct detection benefit, which is substantially more because we're all throwing money on bringing more analysts on the table that we are all doing. But are we getting the value out of that is the question that all of us are not able to answer. Right. So that's the problem that we need to figure out how to solve.
Because if no one else has any question, can I ask another one?
Hey, Vikas, you're on mute.
Sorry. Yeah, Vikas, I think we have other participants as well, those who have raised hand. Maybe you can put your question on the chat and then team will come back to you. And okay. Let's see if you know, I've unmuted other parts.
Yeah,
go ahead.
My name is Gautam and Shamran, thank you so much.
Hi, Gautam.
Hey, sometimes I get this question. Okay, we are in the path of implementing SIEM. We are exploring that. We work with Fortune 500 companies, we work with very important clients out there. So, and we use our endpoints to connect to the environment. Just want to understand, what is the type of data we take, maybe it's on-prem or to a cloud environment. It's always a question for us. What is that you're going to take out of our mission? What are the logs you're going to do it? And how do we go about it? So I'm not 100% sure to answer the question. Just want to check with you as well.
Gautamar, I think the answer lies in, you know, you saw the demo that I gave you. Will need to refer to the MITRE framework is a great, attack framework is a great place to start. Although MITRE Corporation has one more project called CAPEC, C-A-P-E-C, which is also very, very, it's an awesome project because it documents the length and breadth of the attack, the attack database, right? So if you will need to figure out how you're going to be able to detect these threats based on you will figure out the kind of data you need based on what threats you're going to detect. So if you saw in that demo, you saw that the MITRE framework was there and you saw all the data types that were there, right? And you saw that firewalls, endpoint data, DNS data, all of this contributes to this map. So depending upon how you want to cover your map, you will have to figure out what kind of data is required. For that, you will need some kind of a tool that does it. I mean, NIF is one solution, but there are other options which are available where it tells you that, hey, listen, if you want to detect this particular attack, you will need that kind of data. You will need probably endpoint data and registry monitoring capability. So you will need to do this objectively in your environment. And this is not there is no template answer that. And unlike what most of us tell you, I mean, I classify myself as a SIM salesman. Unlike most of us tell you, there is no template answer to this. You will have to figure this out in your environment, because there are times where some customers have very little infrastructure data, but a lot of application data, and the whole world is different at that point.
Got it. Thank you so much.
Great. I think we are running out of time. It's already 12:01, so we cannot take more questions. So what I request is the NIF team, if you guys can collect the questions from the chat and then reach out directly, yes, that would be great. Or you can share the answers with me. We will post it on our site. So that's another option. Guys, I'm going to rush the closing.
Vikash, we would respond to all the questions. At the same time, we'll just put an email as well on the chat. So anyone who has any question, they can reach out to us.
Okay, sounds good. Sounds good, guys. So I'm going to rush the closing. Thanks a lot, Soumen. Great session. Guys, if you want the participation certificate like this, what you can do is go to Elite CISO's website, click on events, come to upcoming events, and click on CPE certificate link. Once you click on the link, you will get to a Google form like this. Put your email address where you want the certificate, put your full name and the password to download the certificate. Before I share the password, guys, it is small case. Okay. I'm requesting, it is small case. It is not capital. First letter is not capital, because every time I get multiple emails saying that we did not get the certificate. So if you put it in lower case, unfortunately, Google Form does not have a function which can lower the entry automatically. So you have to enter the password in small case, and the password is billion. Why billion? Because this week in 1990, Microsoft crossed $1 billion revenue. Okay. So the password is billion, B-I-L-L-I-O-N. If you enter that, you will get your certificate over email. Now, since you're over here to get your certificate, I invite you to register for next Thursday's session at 11 o'clock. We are doing the session with CrowdStrike, and the topic is going to be adopting a frictionless approach to zero trust security. So in past, we have done many sessions around zero trust. I'm looking forward to this very session, because it is going to talk about how seamlessly you can integrate zero trust in your environment. Okay, guys. So go ahead, register for it. First 100 people to register for this will be eligible for Apple AirPod raffle. Okay, so Apple AirPod will be given away to first 100 people who will register for it. How do you register? Very simple. Click on register now and you can simply register for it. Now, since you're on website, I want to highlight a couple of more things. We do weekly podcast as well, guys. We stopped in between and now we have recently started. Very relevant topic, what we discussed today about hyperscale SIM. This discussion I had last week with Mr. Rahul Moni, CIO, CISO and CTO for Absolute Data. And he beautifully explained how you can use open source SIM, right? So it's again a knowledge-based session. You can go ahead, watch this podcast, and you can see how you can build an open source SIM as well. And there are multiple other topics that we talk around. So you can go ahead and watch the recordings as you like. Apart from this, over this coming weekend, right, on 31st of July on Saturday, as we are doing the weekend sessions as well, apart from our typical Thursday sessions, so we have an excellent Elite Gyan session. So it's a new theme that we are building, where it is not a vendor, it is not a partner driven, it is not tool driven, it is not commercial. It is all about knowledge, right? So this Elite Gyan session is on Saturday, 31st July, 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. My dear friend Fal will be managing this session, and we have an excellent speaker, Mr. Nanda Mohan Shenoy. And he will talk about demystifying cryptocurrencies. Okay, excellent session, guys. Over a weekend, don't go out, stay home, stay safe from corona, and attend this session. Great. So last but not the least, what everybody is waiting for is the Wheel of Fortune. So first 100 people who registered for this session are part of this Wheel of Fortune. As you can see, the count over here is 100. As I said, first 100 people to register will be are typically part of this raffle. Similarly for next week as well, as I mentioned. So I'm going to spin it. I will spin it only three times, right? Three times in the sense, if your name comes at once, okay, we are done with. If your name does not come, we will spin it just for three times, okay? If your name does not come, we cannot keep on spinning it. I will keep the Amazon Alexa in that case. Okay, guys, good luck to everyone. Here I'm spinning it now. And the lucky winner is, oh wow, Mr. Satish, very nice. Satish was the lucky winner, I think, couple of weeks back for Apple AirPods as well. So Satish, are you there? You go to the chat and say yes that you are there. No, I don't think Satish is there. I don't see it in the chat. Okay, I'm gonna spin it again. So guys in Delhi chapter, please put it in a WhatsApp group that he missed it. Let's tease him a little bit. Okay, running for the second time. Mr. N. Senthil from, I think, Bangalore chapter. Sir, are you there? If you are there, go to the chat. And I don't see yes in the chat as well. Okay, I don't see him there. So I'm going to spin it one last time. Okay, let's see. Wow, Mr. Rama Devi, right? Yeah, great. So are you there, Ramaji? Ramaji is there, perfect. Ramaji is member of Delhi group, so great, congratulations. Send me a WhatsApp with your address and we will be delivering it to you. Thanks a lot. That's about it, guys. Thanks everyone for joining in. Thanks, NIF team. Great session. See you guys next week. Bye.
Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks,
bye. Thank you, Vikas, for hosting this. Thank you to Elite CISO as well. Thank you.